Hey guys, welcome to all of you on our channel, that is Achieve IAS. So friends, as you know that on our channel we are targeting the exam of civil services, and for that purpose we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So friends, you might be aware of the fact that we have also a series in which what we do, we daily solve your questions from prelims perspective. So the name of that series is Let's Solve Some Questions for Prelims 2020. So today is video number 16 of this series. So as is clear from its name, this series is not just about solving questions, but it is also about your participation. So we do expect that you not just only be mute spectators of this video, but also participate in the comment by commenting in the comment box if you have any additional information, or you can also ask if you have any queries, doubts in the comment box. So we will be promptly reverting back to you. So now let's start discussion or start our discussion. So today's topic of questions is ancient India. So today we will be solving questions from ancient India in this video. So first question is, the decision making in Buddhist sanghas was based on A. consensus arrived at through discussions or voting. B. dictation by the senior most monk within the sangha. C. consent of the enlightened bodhisattvas. D. an elaborate hierarchy of monks which passed on decisions from lower to higher levels. So we have to choose the correct answer. So let me tell you friends that the Buddhist sanghas were basically the places where the monks and nuns resided. So here the decisions were arrived at through the discussions as well as voting. So the Buddha's followers came from they came from many social groups, including kings as well as workers and slaves. So once they were in the sangha, they all were regarded as equal, having shared their earlier social identity. So D cannot be correct, because D is clearly hierarchy of monks was not there. So and advice of senior most monks or the Buddha himself was sought on difficult matters. So generally the internal functioning of the sangha was based on traditions of ganas and sanghas, where consensus was arrived at through discussions. If that failed, decisions were taken by a vote on the subject. So A is a more appropriate option than B or C. So you might be feeling confused about these A, B and C statements. So obviously then this is clear from the fact that you have to choose the most appropriate answer. So the answer is A. Now let's move to the next question. Next is, consider the following about Barabar caves. First, these are rock cut caves. D, the caves were used by ascetics from the Ajivika sect. Third, Mauryas constructed some of these caves. So we have to choose the correct options, correct statements. So let me tell you friends that all of these statements are correct. So Barabar caves are the oldest surviving rock cut caves in India. So please note the word oldest surviving. So they are the oldest surviving rock cut caves, and they mostly date from Maurya Empire, that is 322 to 185 BCE. And some have Ashokan inscriptions too. So statement 1 and 3 are correct, and they were used by ascetics from the Ajivika sect, and this Ajivika sect was founded by Makhali Gosala, who was a contemporary of Gautam Buddha and Mahavir. So second statement is also correct, and at the site several rock cut Buddhist and Hindu sculptures are also present. So not just Buddhist themes are there or the themes of the Ajivika sect are there, but rock cut Buddhist and Hindu sculptures are also present. So they mainly contain four caves, namely Karan Chopra, Lomas Rishi, Sudama and Vishwajhopadi. So Sudama and Lomas Rishi caves are the earliest examples of rock cut architecture in India. So please note this word, oldest rock cut architecture in India, and note the specific caves. So because these are important, Sudama and Lomas Rishi caves. Now let's move to the next question. Next is, Ashokan inscriptions can be found in first Tanati, second Kandhar, third Supara, fourth Ujjaini. So we have to choose the correct answer. So friends, if you have read the NCRTs in detail, then I expect that you people will be able to solve this question quite easily, because there is a detailed map there in your NCRT regarding the Ashokan inscriptions and the extent of his empire. So that's why I again and again focus that place a focus that NCRTs are very important to cover. So friends, these inscriptions of Ashoka were found all over these places. So all the places are included in it. So there were five major political centers in the empire that were, the capital was Pataliputra, and then there were provincial centers of Takshila, Ujjaini, Tosali, and Suvarna Nagari, and all mentioned in Ashokan inscriptions. So these inscriptions were dispersed throughout the areas of modern day Bangladesh, India, Nepal, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and represent the first tangible evidence of Buddhism. So edicts describes in detail the Ashoka's view about Dhamma and earnest attempt to solve some of the problems that society at that time was facing. So just go through the list of major Ashokan inscriptions in the image below. So I have included this map from the NCRT, but if you see the map in the if you carefully read the NCRTs, this map has been picked up from there. So here you can see major rock edicts in the triangle shape, right triangle shape, and then the Kandhar is there, then Manshera, Shahbaz Gadi. So this area is this area is in your Pakistan, and then there is these Girnar in Girnar also, Sopara, Sanati, and then Kalinga, Jagoda, and Shishupalagad, and Kalsi is the place. So and also then minor rock edicts are there. So minor rock edicts are mainly concentrated in peninsular India, that is Deccan and Deccan part. So here you can see Ode Golam, Rajola, Mandagiri, Nittur, Brahmagiri, Siddhapur, Jatinga, Rameshwar, and Palki Gundu, Gavimath, Muski, and then there is also Berat, Babru, where and Bahapur, where these minor rock edicts are found, and then pillar inscriptions are also there. So pillar inscriptions are very important. Topra and pillar inscriptions are found in Topra, Sanchi, Meerut, and then Rumandai, Rampurva, Loria, Nandangad, Loria, Araraj, Shahasram, and Arora, Sarnath, Koshambi, and Gujarra. So these are a few places where his inscriptions were found. So now let's move on to the next question. Next is the Samanta system in the Gupta Empire refers to a landlordship of large areas affiliated to farmers, be hierarchical lordship of villages and municipalities in the empire. See, the system of a closed cabinet that advised the king, the independent rulership of an adjoining territory providing military support to the emperor. So friends, the answer here is D, that is independent rulership of an adjoining territory providing military support to the emperor. So it can refer to a territorial vassal or governor, so the regional satraps, for example. So but we can't use this term satrap, because this term satrap was used in terms of during the times of Indo-Greeks. So the territorial vassal or governor under a king or monarch in exchange for certain guarantees. So the institution of Samanta finds mention for the first time in epigraphs of northern India dating to the 6th century. So institution is considered to belong properly to the Gupta Empire and is closely associated with the origin and growth of feudalism in India. So Samanta system is basically it is seen in Gupta Empire, and feudalism that is seen in during the medieval times in India or early medieval times. So its origin and growth the roots of its origin and growth are in this Samanta system. So from Harshcharitra we understand this, that Samanta had five duties. For example, paying yearly tributes to the emperor and then paying homage to the emperor in person, and defeated Samantas had to offer their sons and minor princes to the emperor so that they are groomed in imperial traditions and grow to be loyal to the emperor. And also they had to render military aid to the emperor and perform administrative and judicial functions in times of peace. So now let's move on to the next question. Next is the Upanishads talk about finding out the nature of the self. The self here refers to a personality of human beings, be human body and mind, see human ego, D, none of the above. So friends, the answer is D, none of the above. Again, the answer is D. So Upanishads tell us the core of our own self. And and they tell that the core of our own self is not the body or the mind, but it is the Atman. So it is neither the ego. So basically that Atman concept is there in Upanishads. So knowing about Atman was basically knowing about oneself. So Atman is the core of all the creatures, and it is their innermost essence and can also be perceived by direct experience through meditation. So it is when we are at the deepest level of our existence. So as per Upanishads, Brahman is the one underlying substance of the universe, the unchanging absolute being, the intangible essence of the entire existence. So when a person achieves moksha, that is liberation, their Atman returns to Brahman, like a drop of water returning to the ocean. So this is about your fifth question and last question of the day. So if your score is 5 out of 5, 3 out of 5 or 4 out of 5, then it is good. But if your score is 0, 1, 2, then it is very much good, because why I'm saying this, at least you have learned something today in these 10 minutes. So what will matter ultimately is your performance in the real-time exam. So I'm nobody here to judge you. And also you are this UPSC preparation is a gradual process in which you improve yourself gradually as you keep on reading and revising and coming across new things that are in your syllabus. So unless and until you don't solve the questions and you start running from questions by counting your scores, then how will you improve? Because ultimately the purpose of test is to is not to test yourself. First of all, this is very wrong conception that we call this such type of questions or mock tests as test series. So it is not just test series, it is basically a series to improve yourself, because once you keep focus upon the things that you don't know, then you start start improving. And today at least you have seen some concepts, you have come across some concepts, facts which you might not have been aware if in case you ignored this video. So I request you people to please be regular, because we daily upload two such videos, and we will be uploading such videos until your prelims, that is on 31st May 2020. So at least 10 questions if you will be solving daily, then imagine the number of questions you will be solving before entering the exam hall. So by this small 10 to 15 minute video, you can at least daily solve 10 questions, and at least 180 days are there, and you will be covering 1800 questions. So that is a big number. So obviously that means the gradual process, gradual consistency, and the continuity ensures good results. So also friends, lastly, we have various series that are running on our platform for the purpose of completion of your syllabus in a time bound manner. For example, we have Modern India series by Spectrum Publications, and then we have Indian Polity series by M. Lakshmikant, based upon M. Lakshmikant, in which what we do, we daily give you certain targets, and you have to complete those targets, and in the evening you get the 10 MCQs from the given target, and in which you people are required to solve, and at the end of the series you are given a complete compilation. So this ensures your time bound completion of the syllabus, because most of the students today are preparing from home, so they lack that self discipline and consistency. So these time bound series will ensure consistency in your studies. So if in case you are interested to join, then you can check the description box of this video, because in description box we have given the links of various series, and not just of this series, the link of which is shown on your screen and it is also available in the description box. So the links of all the series is there in the description box. If in case you are interested to join, then do ensure that you check the description box. And also friends, the link of our Telegram channel is given there. So on that Telegram channel we have more than 15,000 students that are following us, and they are getting access to our to the various public resources that we share for the purpose of CSE preparation. And we if in case you want to if you want to gain access to those public resources and also the PDFs of these daily MCQ discussions, then you can join our Telegram channel. So to join that, you have to check the description box, because link is there in it. So this is all about friends today's video. Do ensure that you like it, share it with your friends, and also ensure that you subscribe to our channel. So thank you friends, have a very nice day ahead.